Like to call the Monday, September 16th, 2013 regular meeting of the Eugene Planning Commission to order. As is our custom, we reserve 10 minutes at the beginning of each meeting for public comment. Public comment may be on any matter except items scheduled for public hearing or items for which the record's already closed. Generally, we like to limit those to 3 minutes. And so I have, if you wish to speak on something not on the agenda, or excuse me, not on the that's scheduled for public hearing or for which the record's already closed, if you could fill out a green slip fairly soon. I have one. Paul Conti. Oh, we took your mic away.
Use John. Well,
yeah. Yeah. Or maybe use Gabe's.
I can just sit in John's place and vote for you.
There you go.
There you
go. You got me. Good morning. I'm Paul Conti, and I live at 1461 West 10th Avenue. In the next several days, you will receive a copy of a petition to LCDC to order the city to obey the statutory requirement to determine that a development project approved for MUPTI conforms to the local comprehensive plan. The city manager has made the ridiculous claim that this requirement doesn't apply to MUPTI decisions, even though the requirement is right in the statute that establishes the tax exemption program. Since city code assigns exclusive authority to the Planning Commission to make recommendations to council on land use plans, I'd like the commissioners to review this petition and recommend to council that council agree to comply with the statutory requirement. I recently learned that Ann Davies, our newly appointed deputy city attorney, has herself had experience pursuing an LCDC enforcement petition on behalf of Landwatch Lane County. In the Landwatch Summer 2013 newsletter, a brief article notes Ms. Davies' new position and commends her for serving as Landwatch's legal counsel in, quote, the successful effort to make the county's appeal process more equitable and affordable, end quote. In a longer front page article, Landwatch President Robert Emmons gives his version of why the LCDC petition Ms. Davies worked on was denied. Mr. Emmons wrote, quote, on March 21, 2013, Laurie Siegel, Ann Davies, and I attended the LCDC hearing of our case. Mr. Emmons goes on to say, however, the DCLD staff report employed an analysis of, quote, good cause, quote, that Attorney Davies had to spend considerable time in her brief repudiating as erroneous and not required by administrative rule, end of quote from the article. I'm hopeful that Ms. Davies' actions as deputy city attorney will benefit from what appears to have been an unfortunate experience of DLCD staff skewing their report to shield a local jurisdiction's decisions from fair and effective scrutiny by LCDC commissioners. The LCD commissioners themselves have a responsibility to not let DLCD staff lead them to a foregone conclusion by selectively citing the jurisdiction's facts and arguments while omitting a balanced presentation of the petitioner's facts and arguments. And if the Landwatch article is accurate, the LCD commissioners should not have limited their deliberations to the apparently invalid framework presented by staff. As you can learn from reading the MUPTI petition, the city manager has consistently attempted to misinform the city council, LUBA, and now LCDC as to the legal framework, evidence, and petitioner's arguments. I trust our deputy city attorney will not continue with a strategy that relies on finesse and deception to defend against challenges from the public that are due full and fair consideration by decision makers. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Conti. Anyone else wish to speak? Seeing none, we will move on to the next item on the agenda, the Benson appeal of the hearings official decision Z13-2 for deliberations and action. And before we get started on this, we have a few things I wanted to kind of go through. First, I think maybe ex parte contacts, and I'll start. There was a Register Guard article on July 22nd that I did read, not realizing at the time that that would constitute an ex parte contact. So I did read that article. I do not feel it will influence my decision one way or the other today. And so I wanted to just put that out there in the interest of transparency. And any other commissioners have any other ex parte contacts to declare? Jeff?
I read the same article as you did, Commissioner Randall, so I have the same exposure. I don't think it's going to affect my judgment here.
Okay. And then I think, Commissioner Baker, you had asked for just a procedural item, and then from there we'll move in, I think, to staff presentation from that.
I was a little disappointed in the AIS because of...
If you could speak into the mics.
I was a little disappointed in the AIS, and I'm suggesting some changes that I think in the future that will make sure that the information would be more complete from my perspective. One thing is relevant dates. For example, on page 3, it never mentions the date of the public hearing. And so if in the future we have a checklist of important dates and make sure when you prepare the AIS that you've gone and all of the relevant dates are mentioned, could be a little table. In fact, the way sort of this extra information is. And the other thing, particularly in this case, is I thought that we could do a better job of managing the documents. There's nowhere in here a link to where you can find the documents. In the case of this case, we have planning commissioners have stuff in Dropbox. There's stuff on the original site. And none of those links are in this document. So if someone from the public wanted to actually figure out and read the documents, you have to be a, the lawyers and the planning commissioners were used to sort of struggling through this, but I think the public would be better to have. So another checklist to make sure that there are links to where all the documents are, not necessarily a list, but at least where they all are. And those are my suggestions for the future, guys.
Thank you. John.
My apologies for being late. Zach, could I get a copy of this, please?
Sure. There are several copies on that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, with that, I believe next we'll have the staff presentation, and then I think Ann will give us legislative history. So,
all right. Good morning, commissioners. I'd like to begin today and just hit a few dates on a timeline, essentially key dates of how we've got here, a roadmap of the application to date. This was deemed complete in February. It's gone before the hearings official for two public hearings in April 10th and April 24th. The Planning Commission, or I should say staff, received the official appeal statement, which you have in your packet, shortly after the hearings official issued his decision. And the Planning Commission held their public hearing July 9th of this year. We were subsequently approached by both parties with the request to delay the deliberations, and then those parties came back to us and said, let's return to deliberations. So we find ourselves here today. Due to that, the extension, or due to those requests for delay, we have received adequate extensions on the 120-day state mandated timeline, so we're well within that and have adequate time for you all to make a decision today. Next, I would like to move into two issues that were raised by commissioners at the public hearing, the issue of the site review overlay, which Chairman Randall raised, and the timeline of events that Commissioner Mills inquired about. First, in regards to the site review overlay, the hearings official essentially sided with the applicant in determining that there was insufficient policy basis on or foundation on which to require the site review. He felt that the multifamily standards that had been adopted into the code would be sufficient to advance that policy language, and viewed the policy that was in the Metro plan as aspirational. And that's, of course, covered in more detail in the AIS, and I imagine we'll get into that later. Second question that was raised by Commissioner Mills, the timeline of events. That's included in the AIS, pages 4 through 6. It's also provided in a handout that you received today with copies there on the counter as folks were coming in. That attempts to marry our text to the relevant and pertinent passages and excerpts from the record, since it is so lengthy. And that essentially provides a clear and direct line of the designation of this parcel from the 1987 blob map, as it's called, the plan diagram at that time, to the current designation today and throughout that that time period. With that introduction, those questions addressed, I would just turn it, I'll turn it over now to Ann Davies to cover a few legal issues that may be at play today.
I'm just going to mention a few broad issues just to kind of get you on the right page. We talked a little bit about standard of review. I think when we had the first hearing, that came up, and I just want to touch on that again just to be clear what your standard of review and how you're looking at the decision. You're not making the decision in the first instance. You are a review body, so you're reviewing the hearings officer's decision. It gets somewhat complicated in trying to figure out the burden of proof, because it almost seems like the burden of proof doesn't stay with the applicant, which it's supposed to. But the burden of proof to demonstrate compliance with the criteria is always on the applicant throughout the process. There are actually LUBA cases that talk about this because it's kind of confusing. I'm just going to read just one sentence from a LUBA case that kind of explains it. If you have any questions now or in the as we go through it, please ask, because it's important that you get this clear. While a local appellant may have the burden under local code provisions of demonstrating error in a lower local decision maker's decision, the applicant for permit approval retains the burden of proof concerning compliance with all applicable approval criteria. So the applicant has the burden to demonstrate compliance with the approval criteria, but that doesn't mean that the appellant doesn't still need to demonstrate error on that part of the hearings officer. So what you're doing is you're reviewing the hearings officer's decision for error. The code language says fail to properly evaluate the application or make a decision consistent with applicable criteria. LUBA uses the short frame of that as error. So that's basically what you're looking at, to see if the hearings officer failed to properly evaluate the application or make a decision consistent with applicable criteria. So that's just the standard of review. Briefly, I want to talk about legislative history, because that probably is going to come up in your discussions. When you're determining what the designation of this property is, you're looking to determine what the intent of the City Council was in making that determination. What did the City Council intend this property to be designated? And in doing that, you look at these, it's called the PGE analysis, text, context, and legislative history. So you're looking at the text of the diagram itself, or the metro plan itself. If that's not clear what the designation is from the text, you can look at legislative history. Actually, you can look at legislative history in determining that. So staff has presented some legislative history. Opponents and applicants have submitted legislative history. Anything that the City Council looked at in making the determination is legislative history. You get to decide how much weight to give to different pieces of legislative history. So the more attenuated it is from the City Council decision making, maybe it has less weight than some other things might have. So that's up to you to determine that weight of evidence. But anything that they've looked at or considered in their determination of what this designation is fair game for legislative history. Just briefly, I want to talk about collateral attack. That's a legal, kind of a legalistic term. There are a lot of arguments from both sides in this that bring in the concept of collateral attack. So basically, if you have a decision that was made 15 years ago, there was an appeal deadline that ran on that decision. You can't come back later and challenge that decision. I'm not going to get into the specifics right now of what that is, because there are lots of different places in this where people throw that out. I like to stay away from the term collateral attack, because it just, people use it in different ways and sometimes wrongly. So when you're, if you have a question about, well, is that something they can validly challenge, I would prefer if you ask me and we can talk about it at the time, rather than kind of saying that's a collateral attack, because people don't always understand what they're saying when they're saying that. So, do you have any questions about that piece? Yeah.
I had a question about your first piece, but I didn't know.
Yeah.
Well, second, actually. Well, standard of review, and, yeah. And when you talk about that, there's a, in the information submitted, there's a memo by Gary Richter.
Yep.
Which talks, not in those terms, but talks about scope of review.
Mm-hmm. You know,
And in there, it indicates that this is not like a LUBA remand, and that we have much more flexibility in looking at the information. From what you're saying, that's not the case?
It's not. It's true. It's not a LUBA remand. It's the first step in appeal from a local decision. I'm not disagreeing. I'm not sure what she says in there. I don't remember reading it and thinking that what she was saying was necessarily in conflict with what we're saying, with what I'm saying. The point that I want to get across is what you're reviewing is the hearings officer decision to determine whether the hearings officer made a mistake. That's the main point I want to get across. Do you have a specific question about how that would be different than what she's saying?
Well, at the public hearing, some of the things that the hearing official may have heard were, let's say, from my perspective, expanded upon and more specific, although they still related to what was in the original testimony.
Mm-hmm.
Are we to consider that, although the hearing official didn't see the more specific?
That's kind of a separate issue. What is the record limited to? The record is supposed to be limited to what the hearings officer looked at. And the reasoning is that you're determining whether he made a mistake. If you're looking at a whole different bunch of information than what he looked at, then you can't really determine whether he made a mistake based on what he was looking at. So if there's more detailed information, we should talk about it at that time when it comes up, and you guys can make a decision of whether you think that's new evidence or not.
Okay. Just one more.
Mm-hmm.
Is it possible to look at everything and say, based on what the hearing official saw, he didn't make a mistake, but not necessarily did he make the right decision based on what's available now as far as more clarity of the initial presentation?
If you reverse the decision, you have to find what the code says that you need to find, which is basically that he made a mistake.
Well, I'm not saying he made a mistake. It's like a judge and a jury making a decision on someone in a crime. They're convicted, they didn't make a mistake, but later on DNA says, hey, he's not the person.
I think what we need to do is when the time comes and you're looking at that other information.
But they didn't make a mistake on the evidence presented is the way we're hearing it.
Right, but there's, okay. Yeah. So we're not supposed to be having any new information than what he had.
Steve.
I have a question in that regard. So obviously, not all of the Eugene code, like all the multifamily code, was attached. I assume that would be considered part of the record that we can use. In other words, if there's statements here about that it complies or doesn't comply with the compatibility issues, we can use our knowledge of the current Eugene code.
The current Eugene code is, you can take, yeah, you can look at that.
And then my question is, what we look at limited to the assignments of error that were presented, or is it limited to everything?
Assignments of error. It should be limited to the assignments of error
are. We should limit our review and consideration to just the assignments of error presented to us in the appeal.
Yes.
Okay. Any other questions? Okay. We have three main assignments of error, and what I was wondering is if we could go through and do I'll call it a non-binding straw poll of those three key questions, just to kind of get a sense of where we're at coming into the deliberations, so that we can kind of gauge our time and how we arrange all of this. So starting with key question one, which shows up on page 8 of our agenda, the question is if we believe the hearings official erred in finding the zone change consistent with the metro plan. And I guess I'll just briefly ask if we're leaning toward agreeing that he erred or that he did not err. So I guess I'll ask it that way. John?
May I suggest, given the complexity of that question,
mm-hmm.
that there's a thumbs up, a thumbs down, and a thumb sideways, that we're not sure.
Sure. That's fair. You bet. So thumbs up would mean that the hearings official erred. Thumbs down, am I making this confusing? I'm just realizing that might be confusing. If you agree with the hearings official's determination, thumbs up. If you disagree with the hearings official's determination, thumbs down. If you've still got questions, issues, then we'll go sideways, I guess, on the thumbs up. Does that make sense? Okay. We'll try this. We'll see if this works. Okay. Well, and I think I'll start. I believe that the hearings official, I'm leaning toward the hearings official, was correct in his assessment being consistent with the metro plan, so I'll do a thumbs up, and we'll just...
Well, if you're talking to my wife, I'm all thumbs, but I'll go this way for right now.
I'm probably thumbs sideways.
Okay.
I'm probably thumbs up.
Okay.
I'm probably thumbs down.
Okay.
I'm leaning towards thumbs up.
And I'll try sideways, just to hear more.
So that's 1, 2. Okay. On key question 2 would be the similar question about the hearings official's decision relying on the metro plan as the controlling document and not providing further findings regarding the Willikensee area plan. And so if you feel the hearings official was correct in his decision to decide that the metro plan was the controlling document and not provide further findings, that would be thumbs up, and if not, thumbs down. So, John?
Well, I read number, is key question number 2 right here? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. Part 2 of key question 1.
Yes, it doesn't say anything about utilizing it.
I'm on key question 2.
Page 13.
Yeah,
thank
we
you.
Were just doing big. We're just starting big picture, just to get a sense of where to go.
So where are you now?
I'm on page. Key question 2, page 13.
Okay.
Well, if we back up to
sure.
question 1, actually has
3 parts,
3 assignments of error, and we only really talked about one of them. I voted down for the C.
Okay. Well, we're going to get into key question 3 that has about 18 assignments of error, and I was thinking with a straw poll, just
right.
keeping
just
it big
to,
big picture.
I wanted to make sure that all the commissioners that have looked at all of them,
okay.
And beware of the 18 for those numbers.
Okay.
Well, on 3 or on 2.
Yeah, let's just go ahead and move to question 2, and then we'll come back and we'll hit each of these item by item. So key question 2 on page 13 is if we believe the hearings official erred in his decision to rely on the metro plan as the controlling document and therefore not provide further findings in regard to the Willikensee area plan. So if you're leaning toward agreeing with the hearings official on that one, that would be a thumbs up.
if you read the second sentence of that, it was clearly designated. I have to go sideways for now.
Okay.
To talk about that.
Okay.
Thumbs down.
Sideway.
Okay. Sideways.
Okay. Okay. And I'm also sideways, so. Key question three, which would be at the top of page 19. And this may end up being a little bit of a moot point, but let's go ahead and if we feel the hearings official adequately supported his decision with evidence found in the official record. Do we feel, thumbs up would be that we feel that he did adequately support it with evidence found in the official record. Maybe we'll start down at that end, John.
I go sideways. I don't know.
Okay.
I'm going to stay sideways on this for a moment.
Okay.
I think there's a lot of legal questions.
Okay. Okay. John?
I have to go sideways because I think the answer is to one or two.
Okay. Okay. We're unanimous on that one. Okay.
That was easy.
That was, well.
We're done?
Okay. So I think probably the best route to take here would be to go through the assignments of error. Just maybe just go right down the list and start with number one, and we'll start going through these. So the first assignment of error is that the decision erred by finding the application met the following approval criterion, EC 9.88651. The proposed zone change is consistent with applicable provisions of the Metro Plan. The written text of the Metro Plan shall take precedence over the Metro Plan diagram where apparent conflicts or inconsistencies exist. And then sub-assignment of error 1A, and I'm on page 6.
Thank you.
So sub-assignment of error 1A, the decision erroneously found that the Metro Plan designation of the subject property is medium-density residential, or MDR. So, discussion. Okay, Steve.
We can hardly hear you.
Okay.
Hey. Yeah. We'll
try to use the microphone. Some of us don't speak loudly.
They don't amplify. You might.
Well, they've actually got speakers, so they may have turned it down after our feedback issue. So.
I think this issue was very muddy because of some errors that occurred in the process. And
that's it.
Essentially, that we have text that remove this property from the MDR designation, and we have ordinances that did that, and yet somehow we discover a colored map that shows that it's not shown as the way it was documented in the ordinances. So this is very confusing to me. I'd like to ask our knowledgeable attorney here to try to fill in any, you know, extra information she could provide. And
okay, where do I start on that one? I think your job really is to look at first off, you're supposed to look at the text. What does the text say? The hearings officer, what I understand the hearings officer did is he relied a lot on the 2004 housekeeping amendments and said basically that's the answer. And then he went on from there. But he did say all we need to do is look at the text. And then he went on and looked at the legislative history. So he said that that the text was it, and you're looking at the 2004 ordinance that said MDR. And then he went to the legislative history and went through what the staff explained in their AIS about how it started at the Planning Commission and the history of how it started out MDR, and then they said, oh, we're going to change it to LDR, and then someone said, no, we want it to be MDR. So it went through that. That's the legislative history that the hearings officer went through.
Someone said, no, we want it to be
LDR. That was the property owner at the time.
What was that question?
The question was who decided it would be MDR after the...
Sure. The record, and I guess we can jump in the AIS to page 4 and follow along the timeline. That should be page 5. Your comments about the removal of the tax lot are quoted there in the second bullet under Exhibit B. That's actually in the adopting ordinance where it specifically says removal of the tax lot so that the subject site, Tax Lot 101, was not included within the Metro Plan Amendment from medium density to low density. It had been included previously. And moving backward in time, in that same timeline, the September 9th date there in the timeline, Exhibit EE, includes Planning Commission minutes. Included within that is a letter from the then property owner, Dr. Bill McCulloch, objecting to the proposed change of his property from medium density residential to low density residential. That letter is included within your record. And then the following record that is cited within your AIS is a unanimous vote on the part of the Planning Commission in 1992 to recommend that the City Council retain that MDR, or I should say remove Dr. McCulloch's parcel from the amendment that would have changed it to low-density residential. So that's kind of the sequence of events.
I have myself in the queue also, and then Jeff, and then John, and John. Let's see. Spell my John correctly here. As I was, and Rick, okay. As I was looking through the legislative history, the way I saw it progress was that the task force that was doing the Willackenzie plan recommended low-density residential. The owner requested that it retain, that the original metro plan was medium density. The Willackenzie committee recommended pulling that out to low density. The owner objected, saying they wanted it to retain the medium density. That it then went to Planning Commission, who then specifically, I think it was in the Planning Commission information, as I looked through that, specifically talked about, I think it was Amendment 5, if I'm remembering that right, to keep that as medium density. It then was approved unanimously by the Planning Commission, went on to City Council. That was the way I saw the progression of everything in this, that, you know, regardless of which map was colored when, as you looked at that, or at least as I looked at that, that was the way I saw the progression happen. So I'll just put that out there. So, Jeff.
Thanks. I guess I just put my name in when Zach began to read because I wanted to make sure that the record showed that the original objection to the move to low density was from the property owner who wanted to retain his property in the same zone category as when he bought it, and that the subsequent actions appear to be, albeit imperfect attempts, to try to maintain his wish. So in addition to that, I guess I just want to reinforce the characterizations that you just made, Commissioner Randall. I agree with the way your summary and with Zach's.
John Jaworski.
It's my understanding for a metro plan to take place that not only Eugene but Springfield and Lane County have to endorse that. Part of the challenge that I read in saying that he erred was some statements that Lane County really never officially adopted it pursuant to the way that it was presented by Eugene. Did staff research that to see if that was actually or what the actual vote was of Lane County in adopting that so it could become part of the metro plan? And are there ever meetings where the three of these get together and someone says, we all adopted it, et cetera, and is there any record of that? Someone controls who's adopting this process if all three has to do it, I would assume. So someone must have so-and-so. That's all I'm asking.
I can't tell you the vote of Lane County Commission. I think that was included within your question just now, but included.
But not the vote.
And
but
was
but
that ordinance 20319? Was the Lane County one?
20319. No, no. Included within your record, it's Exhibit 00 and Exhibit PP are both the Lane County and the City
right.
of Springfield adopting ordinances.
That was PA 1020 and Springfield's Ordinance 5654.
Yes. Thank
yes.
you.
Okay.
So those are both included within the amendment cycle. I think what you see also is that the ordinance is adopted by the City of Eugene in 1990 or in June of 92. The document itself is dated as September 92, which would be the last adopting date of the City of Springfield. So there is some correlation there that the all the jurisdictions are tracking each other's actions, and those are all.
I'm referring specifically to 2004 one, where the vote that our chair had indicated went through.
Oh, the
20319. That had to be endorsed by Lane and Springfield, and I'm saying, did staff look at that to make sure that went through? Because there appears to be a challenge in there that says that did not, that was not included in Lane County. At least that's what I read in looking through.
Unless I'm mistaken and someone can correct me, I think that the argument was a challenge to 19856, which was the WAP.
92.
Not the 2004. And if you look at
Subassignment 3G.
Yeah, footnote 5 of the hearings officer's decision is how he dealt with that argument. He first said that, no, we've got the ordinances from Lane County and Springfield in here, and they're 1020 and 5654. And besides, the hearings officer also considers this argument to represent an impermissible collateral attack on the validity of the 2004 ordinance. So that's how the hearings officer dealt with that.
So that's where the collateral attack issue comes up. One of them. Okay. John Belcher.
Well, I was going to talk about the 2004 ordinance. I'll wait until we get through the earlier parts.
Rick?
Mine is more of a general question, I think, for staff. It's been my impression that in this situation, when we talk about the 1992 document versus the 2004, is it true that when a new document like this is adopted, it supersedes an earlier document? Even though it's called, I believe, an update?
There's particular specific language in the 2004 ordinance that says this completely replaces the old diagram. Do you have the language on that, Zach?
That's what we're looking for. That is what makes the ordinance 20319 unique in that regard.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear that.
Can you speak up?
That is what makes ordinance 20319 unique, is that it specifically says this supersedes the past. All prior versions, exactly. You can see if I can find that exact language for you.
Then maybe as a follow-up as you do that, if there was an error in a prior document, irrespective of this one I'm asking, I think I can ask this question because it's procedural. Stop me if I can't. If a prior document had an error in it, and that error was carried forward through documents that superseded that document, does it fall back to your conversation or your discussion with the fact that you have a certain time frame to appeal, and after that appeal period is up, you can no longer appeal that mistake because it becomes law?
Yes and no.
Okay.
I think there could be an argument that if you had a true mistake and there was evidence that there was a mistake, you would then turn to try to figure out what the intent of the city council was. And if they were merely rubber stamping something that was a mistake, maybe there was an argument that was strong enough to counter the intent. So the legislative history showing that it was actually a mistake maybe you could say, well, their intent was not that it be zoned whatever. I think it depends on the facts of the case.
And would that carry any time limitation on it?
I think there's an argument that if you had that legislative history argument, that you could get around that.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. John Belcher.
Well, now that you brought it up.
I tried to do my best.
My recollection at the time was that this was a housekeeping procedure, and the goal was to take what was the blob map and make it parcel specific. So that would, I think, make the argument that this was not trying to create new zoning designations, but simply to make them more specific. Is that an accurate representation of what that ordinance did?
I wasn't around then, but my understanding was that there were certain properties that were getting redesignated to be consistent.
But those were specifically called out.
And other ones that were not. There wasn't a explicit intent to try to evaluate every parcel in the city. It was really targeted at those where there may have been some inconsistencies.
And those inconsistencies were clarified through the ordinance, but for the rest, if it appeared clear, this was simply moving it to the lot-specific map.
I think that's fair.
Okay, and I would assume that this property, at least at the time, was considered one of those that is just a move to the lot-specific designation.
I don't think we had anything in the record that showed this particular parcel was questioned in 2004.
Okay. In some processes, the timeline starts when you discover the error, not when the original decision was made. And then once it's made clear that you found an error in the decision, then the timeline starts to correct it. Am I correct that there are legal procedures like that?
Not again.
A lawyer.
Yeah, I know. I think I know what you're saying. You're talking about once you discover like a personal injury, the
right.
Time doesn't start to run until you've discovered.
Correct. So if indeed there was an error here, and I'm not saying there was, would that then create an analogous situation where now that you've discovered there's an error, such as through this process, then the timeline starts for you to try to correct it?
I don't think that would apply. I don't see the analogous situation here.
Okay, well, my thought was that, again, if there was an error in the process by which this property was designated medium-density residential, and it wasn't caught at the time, when you recodified it through this amendment and it wasn't caught here, I'm just wondering whether or not this is a new discovery like the personal injury, and therefore the timeline starts now.
Yeah, I don't think it's a matter of a timeline issue, but I think what you're saying is that if there was clear evidence that it was intended to be, so say, low density residential,
for example,
you might be in a different place. If you believed that there was really strong evidence that the city council intended it to be low density residential, then the 2004 action, you know, you may not be able to treat it as like a stone in stone.
Okay, that's what I was asking. Thank you.
Okay. Steve.
Yeah, I want to go back to, again, I looked at this timeline a lot, and I still be a little concerned.
And Steve, if you could speak right into
okay.
the mic,
yeah,
please.
I'm concerned about June 8 and the statement in here, and I just want someone to verify it in the record. So on the first page, the findings state that the Eugene Planning Commission met 6 times to review and deliberate on the revised VLAF plan. These deliberations led to a total of 53 amendments to the draft plan, blah, 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 the dates correspond to, and which resulted in the recommendation to retain. Where was the recommendation to retain? Because the document itself didn't retain the MDR. If all we're talking about is the blob map, that's what I want to know. If all you're saying is, well, the blob map went forward with an MDR, but we don't actually have any verbiage from the city council meetings or deliberations that say that was supposed to be not changed. Because, again, what I'm concerned about, we're looking at a timeline here that started a long time ago sometime in, who knows, before September 1991 for these changes to the Metro Plan. And then parallel to that, the WAP is being developed
okay? And then in June, when the WAP was adopted and some changes were made to the proposed metro plan based upon that adoption, the text has that property zoned as LDR. Yet you have a statement in here that says that it was, you know, you say that there was, you know, what's the record that shows that?
I mean, I think it's
city council, or all you're talking about is the drawing that was adopted had it colored right, and the text showed it differently. If you don't have, unless you have some text from the city council meetings or something that shows that they actually on purpose made this.
Those 53 total amendments should correspond to changes in the WAP as well as changes that were included in the following exhibit, that ordinance 19856. So altogether, there's
right, but the ordinance has a specific property specific list.
Yes.
So where is the text that contradicts that? Is it, or is it just the drawing? That's what I'm trying to figure out.
Okay.
I mean, I acknowledge that the property owner may have wanted to have it MDR, but there was a process developed where they were developing a WAP plan, and sometimes these things get changed, you know, not exactly the way to. And so I'm trying to figure out where is that
mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay, I've got myself. Oh, go ahead.
I think
you got that.
Abe's going to respond.
Okay.
So in the handout we provided, we actually give you an excerpt from, I believe it's from an exhibit to the ordinance, and it says change designation for medium.
Give me a page or where you're reading this from.
I'm sorry, this isn't on the handout. It'll be the second page, one that you were provided today. And this is in regards to ordinance number 19856. Where it states in number 5 here, change designation from medium density residential to low density residential for a 6-acre site on the east side of Coburg Road between Harlow and Handy Turn. If you look to some of the previous evidence, as I recall it, it was originally identified as a 7-acre area. And so in terms of this sequence, we attempt to provide you with how it started with on the first page some of the history at the Planning Commission and their vote with regard to the owner's testimony, and then you can see the change reflected in text, which was an exhibit as I recall, or an attachment to the ordinance itself, and then under amendment number 5, proposed area reduced by approximately 1 acre, which corresponds to the size of the subject property. Remove tax lot 101, assessor's map 17032044, McCulloch parcel, change acreage, number of tax lots, and text. So there is the text description associated with the ordinance that effectively changed the amendment moving forward to council.
Right, so that changed it from MDR to LDR, is that correct?
No. It removed it from an amendment that was proposed that would have changed it to LDR. In effect, retaining MDR. The staff sees it.
That was, so I'm confused now. Well, first of all, this vote happened actually in November, probably, not in June. This is the city council at this point.
That's correct. So that that statement in full for other commissioners on the bottom of page 4, the dates of the deliberation sessions correspond to Exhibit NN cited above, which resulted in the recommendation. So when you go to Exhibit NN, those are the Planning Commission deliberation sessions in which they voted unanimously to remove that parcel.
Right. That was in November.
Correct.
And then now we're talking about city council removing this issue.
Correct.
And this amendment, is this amendment NN from November or from June?
Exhibit NN is the action of the Planning Commission in November.
Amendment number 5. So we have this, and then we have text that shows it the other way around.
No.
Where would you Where do you find that?
Well, there's two ordinances, right? One has a list of specific properties.
885 doesn't have specific parcel properties, I don't think. It has a map. Okay. Yeah.
I thought that was part of the problem, was there was some inconsistency between the ordinance that was adopted and the map.
Commissioner Borofsky is correct. The ordinance 19855 had the draft attachment. A was the draft plan, which included the map that showed the parcel as LDR.
856 as this, that's what I'm talking about, is an inconsistency.
As the more, yeah, correct.
I would say it's just the evolution of that. So 856 is making the formal determination to remove that.
Weren't they voted on the same day?
The draft as it came through was a draft at that stage. So what it's doing, what 856 is doing, is basically making those formal amendments to the draft as it's working through the process.
Yeah, but if they're both voted on the same day and one ordinance has one piece of one point established and the other ordinance has another point established, it makes it messy. I mean, you normally expect that if you were passing something the same day, they would be in agreement, right? Not disagreement.
You know, the hard part with these is that, like any other amendment process, whether that's code amendments or even plan amendments, you're working with drafts as they work through the process until the final stage of adoption, and I think you guys have even experienced that. When we'll carry recommendations of yours up to the City Council, those documents aren't going to be reflected necessarily in the entire ordinance being amended as it goes through. It's usually a list of recommended changes that comes from you to the City Council. So it's usually an evolutionary process as it goes through. But I understand what your point is.
Right. Yeah, I mean, normally you expect it to be, if we don't expect it to be contradictory, that's my concern. We expect it to, you know, follow the same trajectory. In this case, we have contradictory between one ordinance passed one day versus the other ordinance was passed the same day. So, and we have no record of the City Council deliberations at all on this. All we have is a record of the Planning Commission discussions.
Okay. I've got myself in the queue. I have a legal question that has come up that...
announce it and then I'll respond.
I've been given a formal objection to the statement on page 2 under June 8th, 1992, exhibit A.
Yeah. No, there's, can I?
Sure.
Okay. A note was handed to me by, I believe it was Mr. Conti, during my presentation on the standard of review. And my understanding of this note was that his objection was to my outlining my position, the city's position on the standard of review. No. I object. I object to this as new. Oh.
It's impermissible for staff to introduce new evidence.
Okay, hold on a second. So the objection apparently is to this map or citation on page 2 of the memo. Let me look at it a second.
Is that map not in the record?
No, the statement.
The statement.
I'm not really understanding the objection.
Very simple. Very statement of fact there. That fact is not in there. That fact is false.
We can just.
Staff cannot introduce new facts.
Rick, shouldn't this be an issue that's dealt with outside the Planning Commission listening to this discussion?
Well, ultimately, it's the Planning Commission's determination. So let's take a break because it sounds like the other attorney wants to. We can do a sidebar.
Okay.
And then come back in 5 minutes.
Okay. We'll take a 5 minute break. You're after me.
Do we know what statement is being suggested here?
Yeah, we're going to get to that in a minute.
Okay.
They don't follow our sway.
So did
weeks to read this entire
thing. I say, no, we're not going to do that.
Did anyone leave the room that we need to make sure, since we said 5 minutes? Okay. Okay, I think if everyone could. If everyone could take their seats and hopefully return to the room if you're thinking it's a full 5 minutes. We've done a sidebar, and I think Ann, city attorney, will address an issue that has come up. So
summarize what the objection is on page 2 of the 3-4 page memo that you received today. There is a statement in the middle of page 2 that
and
says,
and if you could also speak, I've had a request for all of us to speak loudly, clearly, and into the microphone. Okay. So people can hear.
Subject: site metro plan designation MDR, and there's been an objection to that as new evidence. So all of the parties and the city have agreed that we'll just strike that and move on. The middle of page 2.
The bulleted statement?
Bulleted
statement that says subject site metro plan designation MDR.
Thank you.
Okay.
The map, should the map get?
Just the statement.
Just the statement, I believe.
Maps in the record.
And I have myself in the queue, and if you'll grant me a couple of seconds to remember what I was going to say. It came, I think, after what Commissioner Belcher was talking about as far as timelines and finding errors and those sorts of things. And I guess from my perspective, I'll just share that it seems to me that there was enough specific issues related to this particular parcel at the time of both the original, the 1992 ordinance, as well as the 2004 updates, that it would seem to me that if there were an error or an issue at that time, that I would think someone would have brought that up, since it was specifically addressed originally. And that's just my observation, but anyway, that was just my thought on that. I have next Commissioner Borofsky, then Belcher, then Jaworski.
Okay, so my question and decision process on this thing has to do with the adaptation of 19855 and 19856, because from what I always get the person who, the party that is challenging this, in my view, is saying 885 was adopted by City Council. And in that adaptation, the map that was presented, which we heard about at the public testimony, designated the parcel as low density. So City Council adopted that. And there was no parcel-specific text to that. there was the map. The map said low density. Subsequently, 886 pulled that parcel out and said, no, it is medium. We want that to retain medium density. Now, my question for council is, 885 was enacted first. And it was enacted, from what the petitioners are saying, it was enacted as low density. So is the question then, if 886 was enacted, was that a change of zoning to medium?
You could certainly look at it that way. I mean, that...
And if it's a change of zoning to medium, that's a different process than... Is that correct? There's a different process to change it from low to medium. 886 says it's retaining medium. 885 and retaining medium and changing to medium, my question is, that is a different process, correct? To change a parcel from low to medium is different than retaining it and not changing it to low. Because as I see it, the six acres that were in the change, that was an amendment, and they were saying these were medium, we're changing them to low, okay? But the timeline that I'm seeing is 885 adopted that, because there was no parcel-specific text in 885. The map that was presented to us at public testimony adopted that, and that's low density. So to change it to medium density, it's not retaining, it's changing. And so it would have to be text. The argument that I'm seeing, if I need to find an error, I'm saying, and so my question to council is, timeline, 885 was first.
Yeah.
So 885 was enacted by the Eugene City Council. When 885 was enacted, before 886 was voted on, what was the designation of that parcel? Because that's the question I have to know if I'm going to find an error in the hearing's official decision.
So I'm not sure you need to know the answer. You think you need to know the answer to what it was after 855 before
That is what I need to know, because if after 885,
and if the audience could refrain from,
and before 886 was gaveled, I need to know what the designation of that was, because if it was designated low density in that 5 minutes, then the procedure is different to get it to be MDR.
Well,
I believe that that's what the argument that the plaintiff or defendant or whoever, I'm not, with appellants.
If you're, in order to determine in those 5 minutes what mm-hmm. the designation was, I think you need to go through the PGE analysis. I think you need to look at the text of what you had in those 5 minutes and the context and the legislative history that you had at that time.
To me, the legislative history that I've been presented in the record, I have no legislative history of 885. I have plenty of legislative history of 886. I don't see legislative history of 885.
Well, there may be that legislative
except
history.
For the map.
I don't know if the legislative history is the same for 855 and 856.
So this is part of the challenge.
Yeah.
We have corresponding ordinances coming together at the same time. And what I was trying to say earlier is what we've seen out of just mm-hmm. history with these is that you have a package coming to eventually the council for adoption. And many times what you'll see corresponding to maps and designations are a list of
yes. What
I mean, again, going to counsel, I guess for me, if I'm going to find an error, the way that I would find that error is that that piece of property was designated low density after 885. And the only evidence that I've seen that it's that way is the map that was introduced. Now, if there's other evidence that it was, well, there's the blob map, but that's less parcel specific to me than the map that was tied to the ordinance. Because that's the argument right there. The argument isn't whether or not it's lower, medium, and low. I think back then, and it was the idea to me was clear. You know, the property owner wanted it to retain medium density, but there was a legislative action taken on that property. There were two legislative actions taken on that property, and if the second legislative action, if I'm reading it right, wasn't performed correctly, if after the first one it was LDR.
I think you have a collateral attack issue there. I mean, if you're you still have 19856 and 2004
right.
That designated a medium density residential.
Right.
So how do you get around those subsequent acts?
And I think this goes to Commissioner Belcher's thing saying that those were entered into the record and entered into the general consciousness of the city in error. And nobody had that idea because the subsequent map, other than the signed map, had an MDR.
Okay, so
we've got a signed map and we've got an unsigned map. The signed map has to be the one that you go by, correct? The one that the one that was attached to the ordinance that was signed by the city manager at the time.
Okay, so let's just get a.
Yeah.
I mean, the lawyer saying, let's get away from all the crazy legal arguments. What it comes down to is the intent of the city council. What did the city council intend? Did they intend it to be low density residential? Did they intend it to be medium density residential? I think that's what you need to just decide.
Even though it's been enacted. So you're saying that the intent is more important than the signed document?
Yes, because if there's an error in the map that wasn't intended, that's the error. I mean, it all comes down to what the intent of the city council was in designating that property.
And that's what I need to do.
Okay. I think you also raise a good point, or for me, to jump in and draw your attention to the structure, that even if you as the commission decide that 19855 did designate that parcel as low-density residential, you still have the Metro Plan as the controlling document and adopted through 19856, which designated it as MDR, and therefore, if there is any sort of inconsistency, we go, you would need to defer to the Metro Plan designation.
Okay. Thank you.
John Belcher.
Well, looking at these two ordinances, I see a slightly different situation. It seems to me that they were both sent to the City Council on the same day.
Speak into the mic.
They were intended to show the same thing, but they didn't. And the fact that one was adopted 5 minutes after the other is the Robert's Rule of Order, you can only adopt one motion at a time, so one came first, one came second. So my question is, when a diagram and the text differ, which rules?
When the diagram and the text conflict.
Conflict. Thank you.
In Metro Plan, the text... In the Metro Plan, text takes precedence.
That's correct.
That was my question, John, too.
So is that a general principle of law when they differ the text rules, or is that just true for the Metro Plan?
That's general also.
Okay. That answers my question. Thank you.
John Jaworski.
Wow.
You remember.
It's really, really confusing because lots of things in here, you know, refer to support things that subsequent ordinances adopted in 2004 and all of that by the city, but it doesn't state that they eventually became adopted by for the Metro Plan, because I think sometimes you can adopt something for a city ordinance that what it designates it medium density, but that doesn't mean they're saying change the Metro Plan. At least I don't know that, because this didn't say that one on further to then change the Metro Plan in 2004. The other question I have is when the hearing officials looked at these maps, you know, who provided the maps? Were those maps from the official recorder's office of what was recorded on the vote? So that's the second question that I have.
Which maps are you referring to?
Maps that he based his decision on. Because he states in here, there's something
there
stating in here.
Yeah.
The hearings official's explanation of why the plan diagram, not specific policies, controls the land use designation for the subject site. So what was he looking at when he did that? You know, someone gave him a map, or did he look at the map that was officially adopted and recorded in the recorder's office?
There's an officially adopted version of the Metro Plan diagram in the record. We provided that in its 11 by 17 adopted scale form.
Okay. So it's the same as the one that's in the recorder's office. Good. Thank you. I just wanted to know.
Steve.
I just wanted to make the point that not trying to but normally the way we in the past traditionally Planning Commission makes them some determinations and then...
Could you speak into the mic again?
Planning Commission normally makes some determinations and then within a month or two, depending on how the timing, getting it on the City Council's calendar, the decision is made. And I'm going based on the record here, we have a decision by the Planning Commission in September and November, and then 8 months later, comes to the City Council, and again, I'm imagining that the WAP is coming together during that period of time, and that delayed. And but the point is, I would have felt much more comfortable assuming that the City Council didn't want to make a permit, didn't want to make a change, if this was a month or two after the Planning Commission decision, and that was forwarded on. But now we have an eight-month period of time. That's a substantial amount of time. So it's sort of like, and we don't have any, if we had any record of the City Council deliberations, because we know from our own experience, we only make recommendations, and what the City Council does, you know, it doesn't always come out the way we pass it on. So we don't have any record, apparently, information in the record on the City Council deliberations on this that are specific to these parcels, and there's an 8 month period of gap of time.
Rick,
just a question of staff. The document referred to on this sheet as Exhibit AAAAA appears to be a partial copy of the Willikensee area plan. Do we have a is there a copy of that full document in the record?
Yes.
Can you tell me which the reference is? I looked and I couldn't find it on my link unless I missed it.
Should be there. It's listed in the document, as you noted, as Exhibit AAAAA. That's page 1804 of the record.
But that's what I mean. It's only a reprint of a few pages. It's not the entire document.
Mm. So was it included a second time, Zach?
Because it's not the same document that we called.
No, that's the problem.
No, that's correct.
Well,
the document that shows up as AAAAA.
Like 6 pages or something like that.
Is a color photograph taken from the recorder's office, so it's a select.
I'm fairly confident there's a full copy of the ordinance and all its exhibits, but could you look for that, where that's at? You're looking for 19855.
I think he's looking for the Willa Kinsey area plan, the full plan.
I'm curious because I have a copy which I believe I can look at because it's in the record that's dated September 1992, and it's not the same as what I read in here completely, particularly the map. And so I'm just trying to understand, was there another Willa Kinsey area plan that was a full document, full approval, versus the one that I have here? I'm just trying to understand what it might be. I'm not suggesting so it's not correct. I just would like to know what it is compared to the one that I have that was published basically at the same time this one's documented.
So I'm pretty sure there's a full copy of the draft plan, and hopefully Zach can find that for you.
I think the question, though, is in the record, is what's in the record the draft plan, or is the what's in the record perhaps a different version of the Willa Kinsey plan? Is that what you're asking? Like a final approved copy?
Or I would have a copy that's different than what shows up in here. I'm just trying to understand that. If it showed up as a draft copy.
And is that new evidence?
When you took official notice of the ordinance at the public hearing, that ordinance would have included whatever was adopted as part of that ordinance.
So when we took official notice of 855, then that would, by virtue of taking notice of that, allow...
Yeah, that's an exhibit of the ordinance.
That's an exhibit of that ordinance.
Yeah, I mean, I don't recall that actual document was presented to you, but maybe it was.
A portion of it.
But if we take notice by reference, then whether it was actually physically submitted or not, that's still
not really part
valid.
Of the record. It's you're taking official notice of it, which means you can look at it.
Okay, you think you found it?
Which Steve found it.
Okay,
in the record is Exhibit HHH, which is a draft of the Willa Kinsey plan. And I think what he's complaining about is
not complaining.
he said he wasn't complaining.
No, he's not complaining. Just he has it. The adopted. This is from June 1991 again. Okay, and then we're talking about a city council decision in when is it? It's a year later.
Sorry,
a year later in June 1992. So again, this is a draft. This is not, and obviously what was adopted, the official adoption signed and adopted June 1992 could look a lot different than a draft from a year earlier. I mean, usually there will be lots of changes over that period of time. So there's just some concern, where's the real copy, and we should be looking at the text in there. Just again, for the timing of events.
So then I guess, since no one else is in the queue, I'll jump in and ask if that version of the Willa Kinsey plan is the adopted version that we've taken notice of, can we see what it says? What does it say? What does it show?
I hadn't found HHH. I'm sorry. I haven't had a chance to read all 2,000 some odd pages since Thursday. So I was trying to understand when you were referencing AAAAA, it wasn't a complete copy. I wanted to understand what the complete copy that document came out of so that I understood what it was that we were referring to. And now I understand that it was a draft document.
Yeah. And that was HHH.
Right.
On page 1153 of the record.
Right.
Okay. Other comments? I guess I have a question. Getting back to map and text priority. when we talk map and text priority, does that also include not specifically text in the plan or refinement plan itself, but text related to decisions that are made? I think you were saying earlier that that's a general rule.
When you're talking about priority, you're talking about the text in the metro plan versus the diagram.
Okay. So it's really just specific to the plan, not specific to any planning commission actions or city council actions where those minutes might have text that perhaps...
No, you're talking about text in the
okay.
metro plan.
Okay. So in situations like that, if there were a conflict between a map or diagram and there were minutes that listed some specific text of a discussion, which then would take legal priority?
That the text in the minutes or the text that I think that you're describing is legislative history that informs your decision about what the intent of the City Council was.
Okay. I think I understand that. So that then helps, in theory, us determine what the intent of the Planning Commission or the intent of the City Council was on that particular decision. Okay. John.
Okay. So I guess for the crowd that's here, when the time comes for a vote on it, again, this is my first go around in this type of thing. My feeling is that the legislative intent of the City Council is pretty evident to me by the Planning Commission's minutes and by 886 or 88856. And from what I'm hearing from Council, that should weigh priority over whether or not it was designated LDR before 886. So when the vote comes, based on that information from that recommendation from Council, that I should base my vote on legislative history, because I'm not a lawyer and I don't know this, I think that will sway me to vote to uphold the hearings officials thing. I do understand the argument from the other people, and that I may be 100% wrong on that, but the reason I'm voting that way is based on what I've heard from Council. And if that further up the chain is wrong, well, then that's fine. But I think that's how I'm going to have to come down on this. I understand the argument that they're making, and I hope I've clarified that to the other commissioners, that I understand that that's the argument, that it was zoned LDR and it got changed and that wasn't the correct process. However, I do feel that there is enough legislative intent provided to me in the record that the way that they wanted it was MDR. So.
Any other commissioners want to either weigh in or still ask some more questions? I have John Jaworski and then Steve. I had John first, Steve, sorry.
Yeah, I guess I'm going to follow up on Commissioner Borowski is because it's sometimes confusing to for me to determine what intent is pretty interesting, because, you know, looking at codes and interpretation, it's never what the codes were thought to be, it's what someone interprets them. So, you know, when I look at a contract, usually I've seen enforcement on what's in the contract, not what the writer intended. It's what's written, or it's what's physically there. And so I'm confused. Are you saying that's not the case?
Contracts are interpreted differently. When you're looking at a contract, you're looking at the text, and you're not supposed to be looking at everything that led up to it. Actually, there are provisions usually in a contract that says this is it, and you're not talking about what someone's going to testify later they meant by it. Legislative history is dealt with differently than contracts in that way.
Well, not legislative history. I'm talking about the result. What is actually adopted?
Ordinances are
different. But ordinance and them are different. Thank you.
Steve.
I just wanted to make a couple of points that
Thank you.
HHH is the draft from June 1991. Commissioner Duncan brought in a copy of the McKenzie plan from September 1992, which would be after the ordinance was voted on. So the land use drawing for the Harlow.
Please speak into the mic.
The land use drawing for the Harlow sub area in the adopted plan shows MDR for the subject property. It's different in the draft. And because of the timing, this happened after the city council ordinances were adopted here. But this is from September 1992, and the ordinances were adopted in June 1992. So again, we don't know whether the changes were the timing of things. Obviously, this property has long generated lots of controversy or differences of opinion.
Okay. I've got myself in the queue, and I'd first like to apologize for that remark that I just made on what you said. So I think I'm going to go ahead and state what my leanings are, as Commissioner Borofsky had. I do believe that in looking at the intent of the Planning Commission and the City Council, that the intent was that the property retain the medium density residential status. And regardless of draft maps and, you know, perhaps thoughts and ideas that perhaps the Willikensy Area Committee had, what ended up, in my estimation, getting approved, getting put into place, and that was a medium density residential designation. And so that's, in looking at the entire picture of what I see in that legislative history, that's the way I'm falling on this. And so that will be the way I go on that. Commissioner Belcher.
Well, this is the way I see it. In 1987, the original metro plan diagram had it as medium density residential. There was a proposal in attachment A to the Willikensy plan to change 7 acres to low density residential. The property owner said, please don't change my property. The Planning Commission voted, we won't. The documents were prepared to be sent to the City Council for concurrent approval. Unfortunately, one, the map still showed it as low density residential. The specific text said, we're taking this 1 acre parcel and are making it medium density. Council passed both at the same time and created the conundrum. We're told by our lawyer that if the text and the map differ, wasn't the right word, conflict, that the text follow is the correct determination. We have on page 1190 of the record that map with a written thing saying make this medium density residential. What we don't know was when that was made, but clearly there was a recognition that there was a conflict and it should be medium density residential. My surmise is that that's why the current document shows it as medium density residential, because that is the correct designation. I disagree that the 2004 ordinance locked that in place. If there was an error it made that hadn't been caught and it was treated as a housekeeping amendment, I still think there would be an opportunity to change it if it were wrong, but I don't think it's wrong. So therefore, I think it is medium density. And the only error is one map that got corrected along the way.
The commissioners want to weigh in. Rick.
Yeah, I'm in general agreement with John Belcher on this one. Also on page 1158 of our record, referring to the document that Mr. Belcher was just talking about, there is a note from, I'm going to suggest, Alan Lowe, because it's the way Alan spelled his first name, that says, and this was a draft document because it says draft across it, it says C-map corrections throughout. And there are several places throughout the document where it's been highlighted where there was obviously some, I'm going to suggest, filling of maps that were incorrect, and Alan actually picked up at that time some of these incorrections or incorrect coloring. So I have to agree that, in my mind, the intent of this parcel was always for medium density residential.
Okay. Are we ready to vote on subassignment of error one? We should probably vote on each one, or
what? Why don't you take this?
Yeah. 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 Let's vote on 1A, and that would be the whether or not the decision erroneously found that the metro plan designation is MDR, and so. Do we believe that the hearings official was correct in his assumption, or not assumption, in his decision, that the subject property was MDR? And so I guess those in favor of agreeing with the hearings official's determination of this property as MDR, say aye.
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 Opposed?
Can't.
Okay. So maybe procedure then, as far as subassignments of error 1B, 1C, 2, and 3, we're at 105, and I'm cognizant of time also, John.
Well, key question, are we going by key question or by subassignments?
Well,
because they're different.
They are. And I think we probably should ultimately go by assignments of error and okay. Subassignments.
And I'm still concerned about that 2004 question, but we can get to it later.
Okay.
Bill, if I may.
Yes.
Given the short amount of time and our hope to get clear direction coming out of today's meeting, I would hope if we do walk through each assignment of error that we can get a relatively quick sense of where the commission's at or a vote on each one, get as far as we can today so
okay.
We're able to begin preparing the final order
sure.
Coming out of this meeting.
Okay. And I do understand that I think we've tackled the most difficult point to start with.
One thing you can consider is if there you could see if there's questions or issues with those particular assignments of error, as opposed
okay.
To kind of diving into conversation on each one. It may be that everyone's good with certain ones.
Okay.
Those, and really focus on the one where you still have remaining issues or questions that need more conversation.
So, on the subassignments of error, which ones do people really seem to have issues with?
Combine 1B and 1C together. One C is really the issue. Just one view is sort of a file description.
Okay.
From my point of view.
Okay. How about issues in, let's say, one, either B and C? Does anyone have specific issues with those? Are we ready to vote on those then? Right. 1B and 1C. If we have questions or issues that we need to address on those so that we can start, okay, which one, Steve? Well, I don't want to get into them now. I want to kind of line them up.
1B is a general one and 1C is the specific.
And so you do have an issue with 1C that you want to, okay.
Yeah.
Let's tag that. And then in key question two, A through E, are there any there that are
you're saying key question two,
excuse me,
sub-error?
Assignment of error two, sub assignments A through E, are there any that are burning questions that you have to discuss?
Okay. Two-way is just, again, a confusion again because we have a dates issue.
We have a which issue?
Dates, okay.
WLED and, again, it's similar to the issue we dealt with in one, but there's a dates and time. Now we're talking about the WLED versus the metric time.
Okay.
And,
but are the others...
Did he, were you talking about 2B that you had questions on?
It's 2A and 2B.
Okay. I mean, I have some marks on 2B, and it goes to the city attorney's memo, and that may have been starred on my thing because of the legislative intent thing that we kind of discussed there. So I'd have to go back to decide, but I did have markups on 2B.
Well, I guess what I'm wondering and trying to get to in all of this is if we have determined that the Metro Plan designation of MDR is indeed correct, we agree with the hearings official's decision, which of these additional sub-assignments are perhaps moot?
Okay.
Because I guess I see that as probably the largest issue before us. Okay, Rick.
One of the, I guess I'm going to sort of go to staff a little bit here. Whenever we start talking about policies, we tend to want to talk about them as sort of directive for city versus policies for development. And we've in the past tended to discuss those in each case they've come up so that we have appropriate discussion for findings in final documents. I think policy four is more a city directive type, but I'm wondering because we ran across this on one of our LUBA decisions where it came back at us and we had to then go back and deal with it on remand. Are we better to discuss it and deal with it here?
I think it makes sense to do what you didn't do that first time around in the other case that went to LUBA and make the findings.
Then I'd like to talk about policy four.
Okay. Well,
policy
I'm
four, what is that?
That was in sub-assignment 2B.
It's my understanding,
yeah.
We're just sort
yeah.
of
Yeah.
noting which ones we're going to yeah. come back and have further discussion.
And I guess I'm open to suggestions on how we can best organize this. I know there are a lot of parts and pieces, and I want to make sure we have proper findings, but I also want to do it in a timely manner. John, then Steve.
Yes. Somewhere I remember that originally staff had recommended a site review on the project, and that was sort of ignored by the hearing official or said wasn't needed. I don't know if I'm correct in saying that. You can say what. But in doing that, by him saying no, I'm wondering how that affects these policies. In other words, would the policies be looked at more clearly in implementing when they're building this if there was a site review? Or since there's no site review, all the policies so referenced here are just by the wayside? I guess that's my question. I'm trying to understand if the policies can still be looked at when it's going to be built, or the fact that there's no site review now, apparently, if I understand that correctly, that they're not going to be looked at.
So there's multiple parts to that question, but I will back up a little bit and explain that staff did originally recommend that the hearings official include the site review overlay. And our recommendation was primarily based on the policies of the Willa-Kenzie area plan as opposed to what we believe are the more general policies in this case of
the
A13 and A23, which are dealt with in the first assignment of error there. What we noticed in looking back at the hearings official's decision is that his discussion about applying site review was entirely focused on those policies and did not reach to an analysis, which was included in staff's recommendation of the Willikensy policies, which we thought were more specific. And in this case, you know, I think it was policy 8 of the Willikensy area plan that speaks to promoting compatibility between low and higher density uses. There's actually a proposed or suggested action below that that's even more specific and saying apply site review. And so we were relying on that, at least going into the hearings officials public hearing, as the policy basis to recommend that. We also had an applicant who was willing and actually requesting application of the site review overlay. It wasn't until midstream in that process, in the hearings process, that the applicant actually retracted that proposal and argued that the policy basis did not was not sufficient, in either the Metro Plan or Willikensy Plan. I think part of the question here is whether he erred in not making those additional findings with regard to the Willikensy area policies. First question here under 1A or 1B and C is whether you think that those policies, or if he erred in finding that those Metro Plan policies didn't have a strong enough basis to require the site review. Staff is suggesting it may be prudent to go a step further and make supplemental findings that address the Willikensy Area Plan and explain that as well.
That's where I'm going. Okay. That's what I'm trying to say, and I'm just trying to find out where we say that, because there's nothing in here that says, do we reconsider his elimination of site review, from what I've read.
Well, it's certainly a question that's before the commission here on appeal, as it's been raised, as to whether or not site review should have been required. So you need to ultimately decide, did he err in not applying site review? Or, I mean, alternatively, another way to look at it is, was there a sufficient policy basis to require it? So you need to make a call on that, we believe.
Then if we did do that, then that would say how we handle all of these that relate to the policies in two and further on, right?
I'm not sure I understand your statement.
Well, one can say I want to look at 2B because it's talking about sub-policy 4, and then one could go over to other ones and say policy 3, policy 6. They're all related. And I'm saying if we make a decision on the site review, we're really addressing all of those.
I think that's fair to say.
Okay. Thank you.
So it sounds like perhaps the next topic for us to look at might be the site review overlay. And I guess maybe if we can come to a conclusion on that, would that then expedite or change, Jeff?
I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Oh, no, I'm...
I guess I had a couple of things. One is a question, and then one is just a note. The page 8 of the AIS, second to last paragraph, that starts also staff notes. I guess I just have to say that my reading, I don't agree with your conclusion there, that trying to place one side of the sentence as having more weight than the other side, I think that's a reach. I think I don't buy it. The other thing, I guess, is it has to do specifically with the Metro Plan. We've talked about, you've mentioned that the Willikensy Area Plan is not silent on site review, and it does have a recommendation. Is the Metro Plan silent on this in this case? Or what does it say?
It contains no specific policy that calls for application of the site review in an explicit way as staff reads it. The policies that are at issue here on appeal are A13 and A23, and so I guess the question back to the commission is the text of those policies sufficient and clear enough to lead you to the conclusion that you must apply site review in order to resolve an error in the hearing official's decision?
Well, it seems to me that, you know, given that I'm not reading this the way you're reading, I guess I'm giving more equal weight to both sides of this sentence, which the second half says, while considering impacts of increased residential density on historic, by considering it more, I give that equal weight, not lesser weight.
But do you believe that the language considering those impacts leads to an error, I guess is
that that's you know I that takes me back to my concern about saying okay, Metro Plan has this qualitative guidance to give that says you know here's what you need to consider, where the Willikens Area Plan is a little more specific, okay. But then I'm a little concerned. My other concern is I've just given precedence for the Metro Plan over Willikens to a degree here. Now I'm going to turn around and I'm going to go and give Willikens precedence over Metro. It feels like that. You know, please jump in here and provide any guidance you like. But that's my hesitancy here in switching. That's my only hesitancy because I really feel like it's the one protection the folks in this neighborhood have got left right now is this.
So I you know, this is always the challenge with broader policies that you'll find in the Metro Plan versus more, tend to be more specific in the refinement plans. And part of what you're weighing is that difficulty in looking at a broad statement, thinking about this now for one tax lot and saying, how does that statement necessarily relate to the potential for site review here? It's a little harder to connect all the dots because it's not explicit. Whereas some of the refinement plan policies may be more explicit, they may be geographic based, they may be more directive in nature. I think what's important now, maybe to help in terms of the few minutes we have left, is to think about the Metro Plan policies that are in front of you now, and in terms of the question of error with the hearings official, and whether or not you feel his basis for not requiring site review simply on those policies was correct or not, or whether he erred or not. But keep in mind that we're suggesting that you also evaluate the refinement plan policies next. So the story's not over yet. And we are suggesting that it might be prudent to look at those policies as well. So I don't know if there's a way to take those in order, to look at the kind of back to some, you know, to
so go back one, to question one, sub-assignment
those, but know that we're going to talk about the refinement plan policies, all of the policies that have been mentioned, as Commissioner Jaworski was making reference to. At least that's what we're suggesting.
Okay.
As the next step.
I have John Jaworski next.
Yeah, I don't know if it's relevant now, but my understanding, at least maybe I've been told erroneously, is that once adopted, the Willikens Area Plan is consistent and not in conflict with the Metro Plan. So if it is consistent with the Metro Plan, I don't understand the issue. I know the Metro Plan may have some statements that are more broader, but when you get specific, as you had indicated, Steve, that's not inconsistent with, that's just more specificity. And if it's supposed to have been consistent when adopted by those entities, then it should be included, is where I'm coming from.
I wasn't, if I said something about inconsistency, okay. I wasn't referring to that. I was just saying it provides perhaps more guidance.
Okay. So what I'm hearing is you were saying that the Metro Plan is here and the refinement plan takes that to that next level of detail and specificity. Okay. John Belcher.
Well, this is primarily an editorial comment, and I don't know how relevant it is, but it seems like we're looking at the microcosm of the Vision Eugene and protecting neighborhoods. That we haven't resolved that issue at the macro level. Here we have it at the micro level. I guess I'll leave it at that.
Okay. John Borowski.
I guess my question is, from what you just said, what is the procedure that we're going to go through? Because it seems to me, by my reading of the hearings official's decision, he was justified in saying that these policies, I mean, I read it as he was justified in saying that the policies covered it enough that site review is not necessary. So that's the initial finding. But yet you were saying we're going to go back to it. So can we affirm his decision, yet go back later in further processes and still get to applying site review and putting the plan, the WAP, into what is going to get developed on that property?
I'm suggesting you take it kind of in an orderly way, that you look at the Metro Plan first and those broader policies, make a determination whether you agree with the hearings official's findings that he found those not to be of enough basis to require site review. He stopped short, though, the next piece is of looking at the refinement plan policies to see whether that same question is relevant there as well, to say, if I look at the refinement plan policies, do those policies also perhaps require site review? He didn't go there, and we're suggesting as step two in our discussions, mm-hmm. you go there to have that conversation. So the first step is whether you believe
what. And what section is that in here?
That's in question two.
That's in question two.
Right. So we can find that, yes, at the higher level of Metro Plan, his findings were correct that site review is not necessary. But in section two, we can come back and say, when you boil it down and we look at the WAP, yeah, it says site review is what we're looking for, and we can still get site review.
Because that was specifically addressed in the appeal regarding site review, even though it wasn't one of the specific sub-assignments of error.
Right, and so I just want to make sure that if I vote to affirm point in section one, we're still going to go back and revisit site review in section two.
We're at least suggesting you do that.
Okay. Yes. Yeah, Steve, and then I've got to...
Yeah, I think so.
I want to mention a couple of things to make it clear, and hopefully our council can reaffirm these, but this is a zone change request. And so even though the Metro Plan says medium density, there's a range associated with that. So it's perfectly possible to put it. I mean, we've done it all the time at West University on these zone changes, where we put a density range or height limits or, you know, all kinds of other limits on the zone change because of the location and the policies that were in the West University Refinement Plan. I mean, I could give you numerous examples where that's taken place just recently. You even approved a case like that. So that's normal. That's the normal way you take the plan, you know, the neighborhood plan policies, and you apply them to the Metro Plan. The Metro Plan is general guidelines, gives you a density range, you know, and then you provide them more. If I'm out of line, please let me know. But
well, I think there's a difference between the legal analysis and the policy analysis. Legally, you can do that. Policy-wise, I think the city. Do you want to answer the policy question of why the city tends not to condition zone changes?
Well, I think that, and correct me if I'm wrong here, but I'm not so sure we can introduce evidence or facts related to other cases. When you cite other numerous examples, now I can think of some of those, and I'll speak in generalities to try to help the commission, but. In the instance where we would have a concurrent development plan or an actual site review with a zone change, we may have additional detail or evidence that helps inform the kind of policies, the findings, or conditions of approval that we might apply. And in this case, we don't have that. And so I just caution you all to be fact-specific and looking at the circumstances of this case where we don't have additional evidence in the form of a specific multifamily plan that's being applied for. So I think it's important to distinguish that and look at the policies in the absence of an actual development proposal, and that from a policy standpoint and in practice, the city does not require, and I don't believe has the authority to require in every instance that an applicant include a development plan with their zone change, that it's a logical sequence to look at the plan designation and zoning and then move toward more specific development plans through separate applications. So in this case, we don't have that, and so the task is to look at those policies and determine, you know, based on the zone change criteria and with the policies and the designation, what's the answer, you know. And so I think in this case, it's really a question of applying site review or not, and whether that basis is available. And at least from staff's perspective, we don't see enough detail to reach to details that would govern the footprint or particular setback. We don't have a development plan to evaluate or the criteria in the zone change to do that.
It seems to me you could certainly put a density overlay just like we've done again, which has happened in the past. Well, no, I mean, in other words, you approve the zone change with a density limit.
And the other thing I would...
Doesn't require you to have a design plan in place.
But what you do have to have is a sufficient policy basis either in the refinement plan or the Metro Plan, and that's really the question. And You know, in this case, we're looking at the Willikensee area plan. And in other cases, a different refinement plan may have more specific language or have a different policy level of specificity. So,
but we're talking about, you know, assignment of error 1.C, which talks about the reduce the impacts of higher density mm-hmm. on surrounding, you know, adjacent lower. And in other words, it's our transitions issue.
I've got myself in the queue and then John, and I guess what I'm hearing is that we could perhaps address the Metro Plan policy issues B and under B and C and find however we find, but that the issue of site review could be addressed and actually should be addressed in subassignment of error 2. Should that be something that we decide or go where, you know, we feel the hearings official perhaps erred by not going far enough in requiring site review on this particular parcel to adequately address those protections? And so, I mean, with that in mind, are we comfortable at this short time, and I know John and John both want to speak, of trying to address issues 1B and 1C before we leave today, knowing that the issue of site review, perhaps, among other issues, under subassignment 2, can come up when we address item 2. So I'll go John, and then I'll go John, and then.
I don't know where it fits, but I'm looking at the Willikensee Area Plan, page 16, policy number 8. It says, 8.1 to be specific, apply the site review suffix to all parcels designated medium or high density residential land use which directly abut low density residential uses. This is a medium density parcel. It abuts low density residential. What's the question?
I think the question is, did the hearings official err by not addressing that specifically
Absolutely.
In his decision, which comes up when we get to item 2.
Okay, I don't know where it fits, but I think site review is mandated.
Okay. John, then Jeff.
Yeah, I just want to say that the reason I asked a prior question, if they're consistent, then I'm very uncomfortable in saying he could say when he looked at the Metro that he didn't err, when in fact he did, because the Metro, to me, is also consistent with the area plans. I mean, this could be somewhere else, and saying that, you know, the impacts of increased density in something in the university area doesn't apply. Well, it does. I mean, because they have a plan there too, I'm sure. So I can't say that he didn't err here and then say we're now looking at this, if in fact they are supposed to be consistent when adopted the area plan and the Metro plan. That's where I'm coming from.
Jeff? I'm having trouble parsing where we should put it also. I'm going back to my original statement where the assignment of error says failed to consider impacts of increased density, and staff's attempt in the statement below to say it had less weight, and I'm disagreeing with that. So I guess I'm leaning towards saying that this is where it belongs in 1B. This is where the site review requirement belongs in 1B, not in 2. And I just put that out there for to be challenged. Please give me some guidance, because right now that's where I think it needs to be.
Or could we find that the hearings official erred by not considering those impacts and then apply site review under 2? Would that be more appropriate?
Let me try a couple quick things. One, going back to Commissioner Jaworski, the fact that you may have broader statements in the Metro Plan saying one thing, more specific policies in WAP saying another, doesn't necessarily mean that if you decide that the WAP provided for site review that directly then impacts your finding for the need in the Metro Plan to be consistent and therefore find it also violates it there. It's just really, as you look at the statements there, are they specific enough? Do they provide enough guidance in the Metro Plan to be able to justify site review on a case-by-case basis? And if the answer is no, we agree with the hearings official, that doesn't mean the question's over. You may then find, as Commissioner Belcher appears to be finding, a policy that says very specifically apply site review, blah, blah, blah. And you may say that, to me, seems like a better place to use as our finding because it's more specific, it's more directive, all those other things. You always run the challenge in the Metro Plan, and we've had this conversation many times, that sometimes that broad language can be read in various ways, and it may not be specific enough to support the finding you have. So where you have findings in the refinement plan, they're usually going to be a little bit, tend to be a little bit better to rely on, even legally, to use as justification than those broader metropolitan policies. That's a very general statement, but it just, in a general way, that tends to be the case.
John, and then we need to...
Not to belabor this, but let me, just so I can get something clear with doing that breakup of Metro and one other. In the Metro plan, since one says they're consistent, in the Metro plan, does it ever reference area plans? Does it ever say that they're part of the Metro plan? Because if it does, then I can't see breaking it up.
Well, our refinement plans are part of the city's overall comprehensive plan. The Metro plan does speak to its relationship with the refinement plans. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. So to me, they're one and the same. Thank you.
Okay. I'm not sure we're going to resolve this today. Mm-hmm. So I think we're going to need to, John?
Well, could we give an indication to staff that we are supportive of the idea of site review planning somewhere?
I think that probably would be appropriate. And I know I am leaning toward putting site review back in specifically because of policy 8.1.
I'm leaning, definitely.
And
I'm not leaning at all.
Well, okay. So are there other things as we wrap up that are critical for you guys as we move forward?
Well, one thing that would help us, I mean, what we would like to do, our goal today was to get enough direction so we can start preparing a final order for you to review. And okay, I think I want to try to get some of that in front of you as best we can based on what we've heard. And one of the other pieces to that I thought I heard around the table wasn't just around the site review question, but it was the broader issue of making findings around the refinement plan policies as a whole. Perhaps the most important thing is about the site review, but there are other factors that we may want to capture. So I would propose that we come back with the draft final order that actually includes what staff had originally recommended to the hearings official, which included more elaborate findings around refinement plan policies for you to evaluate, as opposed to waiting to hear you say, do that. I'd rather put it in front of you because it seems like that's the road you're on right now, and at least have you respond to those.
Is it possible or is it legal to get those to us prior to the meeting for our deliberation, or does that violate?
We'll do the best we can. We're on for next week.
Okay.
So it's not going to be too much in advance.
I understand from a timing standpoint. I just want to make sure from a legal standpoint that's not
final until you signed it.
Okay. 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 John.
I'm fine with that, but I don't like the way that was worded. I don't like the fact that you're saying we're drafting a resolution or whatever the document is going to be before you've heard our input. I think you can give us direction, but I don't want to see a draft document because then what the hell are we doing here?
No. I wasn't saying about everything. I was saying the things that you've talked about.
Right.
And trying to get in real time some response to
But the way you said it was, I would like to give you the draft resolution or whatever you're calling it, and I'm not comfortable with that. I definitely want to say, okay, this is the way we want to do site review, and this is where we think it would fit in well. Would you consider that? That's what I want to see. But I don't want you guys writing our opinion until you've heard our opinion.
Sure. I just want to give you stuff to respond to, something that'll help your conversation.
We can withhold that if it's the commission's desire. We can refrain from providing a draft if majority of you would not prefer to see it.
I'd prefer it. I was going to check my emails tomorrow morning.
John?
Well, you might want to do it in the way that you did with this, which is key questions. And then from there, if you say yes, then this. If you say no, then that.
Sort of a bullet
that might
list.
Yeah. And I didn't. And I
know it's more work.
And John, I didn't take it that he was going to draft
again,
it for us.
It, so I don't know. But that's what I heard, and I wasn't comfortable.
What I picked up is that you were going to start with getting us some drafts related to the MDR that we decided on, as well as some perhaps suggested
direction on site review, since that does seem to be a direction we're all leaning that we've expressed. Okay. Steve, and then we're going to need to adjourn.
But just also, I think it would be useful if, like you said, it's not just site review, it's another condition, so it's the other land use policies for and whatever lands, you know, so that it covers the gamut of what, you know.
Okay.
We're adjourned.